Jim Turner. Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Still here?
Hi, Kelly, you're still here?
Oops. Hey guys, I've already thought out all the pictures, so
yes, I am.
It's going to be all kinds of stuff. We're going to
get
you down, and we've got a program for pictures. So
what are you doing pictures for?
Everything. Good evening and welcome to the July 21st, 2015 City Council meeting. Will you all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance? And Judge Dave Larson, would you please lead us?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you for joining us. We've got a great crowd. We've got, as they say on TV, we've got a really good show for you tonight. We'll keep things moving. The first thing we have, before we get into presentations, is Councilmember Maloney is not with us tonight, but she is with us telephonically from a remote location. She had a family issue that has taken her out of state. She is on the phone. I will excuse her at this stage during the session, and then have her brought in at some point when we get to the relevant portion, I believe, for the pro-con business for the committees. So she's excused at this time. At this time, I'd like to ask the swearing in of the new officers, Travis Stevens, Officer Chase Smith, Officer Adriella Kapp, and Justin Gregson to come forward with the chief. And I believe the chief will have a brief presentation, then we'll do the swearing in.
Good evening, Mayor Farrell, Deputy Mayor Burbage, and members of the council. It's my pleasure to introduce to you the newest members of the Federal Way Police Department. First, we have Officer Chase Smith. Chase is an entry-level police officer, recently graduating from the Police Academy in June 2015. He was raised in Edenclaw and graduated from the University of Wyoming with a BA in communications. During high school and college, Chase was an accomplished wrestler. He attended college on a wrestling scholarship. Next, we have Officer Travis Stevens. Travis is an entry-level police officer as well, recently graduating from the Police Academy in May 2015. He was raised in Texas and joined the United States Marine Corps in 2007. Honorably serving through 2013. Travis is married and has a young daughter. His previous employment includes corrections, working for agencies in both Texas and Washington. Next, we have Officer Justin Gregson. He was hired in July 2015 as a lateral police officer with 2 years of law enforcement experience as a Washington State Trooper. He earned his BA in sociology from Pacific Lutheran University, and he was honorably served in the United States Army Reserves from 2003 through 2011. Next, we have Officer Andrielle Kapp. Andrielle was hired in July of 2015 as a lateral police officer with 4 years of law enforcement experience from Burnham, Illinois, south of Chicago. She earned a BA in Sociology and Criminal Justice from Purdue University and recently obtained a master's degree in criminal justice. She is an animal lover with two very large dogs. Please join me in welcoming the newest members of the police department.
Raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, state your name.
I,
do solemnly swear that I am a citizen of the United States
and the state of Washington,
that I will support the Constitution and laws of the United States
and the Constitution
of the state of Washington,
and will to the best of my judgment,
skill and ability,
truly, faithfully,
diligently and impartially,
perform the duties of police officer,
in and for the City of Federal Way,
County of King, State of Washington,
as such duties prescribed by law.
So help me God.
Congratulations. All right, and now that for the next part of the evening, we've got our life-saving awards for life-saving award lifeguards, Kacey Jaenicke and Jimmy Rosenbaum. Could I have you both come up, please? I'll wait till you get up here. Oh, come on up here, please. Hi, Kacey. I'd like to tell you two stories about these remarkable young people. On Saturday, June 20th, the first day Federal Way had lifeguards on duty, a young man jumped off the dock into the cold waters of Steel Lake. As his head went under, he took on too much water, swallowing large gulps, and began to panic. Fortunately, Kacey Jaenicke was there. She immediately entered the water, made contact with the swimmer, and safely towed him back to the dock. Thanks to Kacey's heroic actions, the young man was saved and was able to leave unharmed. I would like to present this certification of recognition for extraordinary personal action to Kacey Jaenicke. I should say, it reads,
Kacey Jaenicke, whose heroic actions directly contributed to the saving the life of a young adult at Steel Lake Park on June 20th, 2015, signed this 21st day of July 2015 by the mayor and city council. We're going to give them an opportunity to speak in just a moment, but the next individual is Jimmy. Jimmy Rosenbaum. Come on up here, Jimmy. Thank you again for being here.
Thank you.
So here's Jimmy's story. On July 4th of this year at approximately 6:25 p.m., a four-year-old boy was spotted by Jimmy Rosenbaum near the drop-off point at Steel Lake Park. He was in a textbook active drowning state. Jimmy immediately made contact with the young boy and took him to shore. When asked where his parents were, he was not able to give information to the lifeguards. The guards found three relatives who informed the staff that the boy was autistic and was not able to communicate effectively. As the father of a young son, I have to tell you, Jimmy, your actions have touched my heart, and on behalf of the 92,000 people who live here, thank you very much. Do you guys want to say something? And we're going to get a group picture with the council. Jimmy, go ahead. Kacey?
Into this?
Yes.
Okay. I just would like to thank everyone for the recognition. My fellow coworkers and I work really hard, and it's great to be recognized, so thank you so much.
Thank you, Kacey.
That's my sister.
Her sister actually was my son's camp counselor at the community center, so her sister has a very funny camp name. Well, let's take a group picture. Council, come on, one more time. Very proud of Kacey. Her mother, Mary Jaenicke, has been a longtime employee of the City of Federal Way. Mary, stand up and take it. Mary, how many years?
22
years with the city, you guys. You said Jimmy, actually, I kind of turned around. I thought you were talking to me. I haven't gone by Jimmy in a long time.
Yeah.
All right, now we've got some very special guests with us, and really, you guys, we are so fortunate in this area, in the 30th District and Federal Way in the South. King County area, to have just amazing representatives and senators in the state legislature that have just done a tremendous amount of work for us. At this time, I would invite our state Senator Mark Miloscia to come forward, along with State Representative Linda Kochmar, former council member and mayor Kochmar, State Representative Carol Gregory, who's also a president of the Federal Way School Board, and State Senator Joe Fain from our neighboring 47th District. Almost sounds like kind of announcing them, and in this corner. But come on, you guys. I just want to say we've got some certificates for you, but I'll wait till they get up here. On behalf of everybody in this community, we are so thankful for the work that you did in a bipartisan, cooperative manner. I have to tell you that I've joked several times in the past week, I almost considered changing my cell phone service to add these people into my plan. Because probably about several times a day or during the course of a week, I was on the phone with these individuals, essentially, seeking money for very important parts of our transportation infrastructure, with the Triangle, with the Performing Arts and Events Center, where they were successful getting us that $2 million, which is very important for our community. you know, to trails that are the trail that was going to connect Steel Lake Park with our downtown and be part of that. And this is really about the infrastructure that's building this community. And it was the longest session, and they're going to tell you a little bit about this, the longest session in state history. And think about that. Over the, you know, since 1889, the longest session was this year. But they did so, and they came together when it really mattered and delivered in a historic way for Federal Way. So
here we go. So why don't we give, let's do the certificate. Senator Mark Miloscia, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
So I'm going to stop talking for a minute, and let's let the people that made the news deliver a little bit more. Go ahead, Senator.
First of all, it's very good to be here. I just want to say a few thank yous. First of all, thank you for the council being involved for the long session. For the entire agenda for Federal Way. It was wonderful for your support and making sure that our town stays unified. And I'd also like to thank the public here. I heard a lot of emails and phone calls from many of you talking about the importance of these projects. And we know for some of these projects, for example, the Performing Arts Center has been a labor of love for decades. So it's really glad that we have that now almost accomplished and that we'll move forward and help redevelop the downtown core of Federal Way. And lastly, I wanted to thank my colleagues, which truly was a team effort. You know, there are some things down in Olympia that is kind of partisan, a little bit divisive, but working with these people right here was fantastic. And of course, I must thank the chairs of the Capital Budget Committees, both of the South and Senate, for doing it. But it wasn't with these people working together as a team. And Senator Fain, who's part of our leadership, I don't know if anybody knows, but he only lives like a half mile outside of Federal Way. It's almost like we've adopted him, almost like we got two senators sometimes here. But again, I want to thank you all for making this all possible.
Great job.
You may not know this, but we have received the most money that we have ever received for the 30th District this year. And over $5 million for capital projects in at least 18 years, according to Senator Miloscia. And so we were very happy to work on your behalf. In addition to that, we also received, I was able to pass a bill that would take money from lodging tax, thank you to Deputy Mayor Burbidge, Mayor Farrell, that would bring in $400,000 a year from lodging tax for you to use for public outreach for your public performances. I'm very pleased with that. I'm very pleased that in the transportation revenue package, nobody likes a gas tax, that did pass, but we are a big winner in this 30th District South Sound area. We will be receiving, thanks to Senator Miloscia for putting in an additional $5 million, $85 million to complete the Triangle Project. We will receive, we will complete Highway 167, Highway 509, and the entire transportation ribbon project will bring in 80,000 new jobs. That's 80,000 jobs that are living wage jobs, prevailing wage, $33 an hour. All of those people out there who are looking for to switch occupations, look for going back to school, look for journeyman, look for apprenticeship programs in the construction industry. You can just Google WA.gov and Google apprentice journeyman, and you will find very likely over the next few months a lot of advertising for that type of a position. We will recession-proof our area for the next umpteen years. I'm not sure. I hate to say 15 to 20, but I think that this will do us well, not to mention the fact that you're not going to be spending 2 hours a day in traffic trying to get back and forth to Seattle or to Tacoma and beyond. So it was a pleasure working on your behalf. I did put myself on the Capital Budget Committee in the House. I intend to bring you more money next year. That's my job. My job is to bring money back to my district and to bring you jobs, quality of life for Federal Way. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. I think you all know I was the newbie this year. And Mark is correct. The excitement of this year was not only learning the process and being able to be successful in legislation, but it was the ability to work together to really make a difference for Federal Way and the rest of the 30th District. We were very successful to bring projects to all of the communities that we represent. Algona is receiving money for a community center. Pacific is receiving more money to build, to continue the interurban trail and to work on their senior center. Milton has some safety requirements that are going to be specific to the police department in securing their facilities. And they also received a trail or money for the trailhead for the interurban will now have a parking lot and lighting and some signage. So those are some of the other things that we were able to bring home. It's not a matter of just working the big issues, it's a matter of also looking at the issues that directly affect your community. Mental health funding is going to be added to the resources available for those in need in our areas and helping cities and counties assist in ways that we've not been able to do before. As you probably know, I'm on the education committees. And I must say that this was a good start in education. It isn't the finish. $1.3 billion for K-12 education plus increases for school employees, financial increases. But we also passed some major legislation, and it was bipartisan again, on early learning. And this is going to be dramatic to the whole education system. We've got $158 million to begin to work with care providers in our community around early learning. The other thing that I will just end with is higher education. And I'm on that committee, and until I went to that committee, I didn't realize what we have done to our higher education system in the last few years. And it wasn't intentional in many ways. It was because we were in a recession, and higher education is not required as in the Constitution as the as K-12 is. And so we began the road back, and particularly I credit the Senate Republicans for pushing us to do the first tuition cut that we've seen. I don't know if we ever had one, but we're the first state in the nation to actually cut tuition. Now, that is only a 5% cut at our community colleges. Well, it's a 5% cut, but at our community colleges, because they're state funded, that's a real hit. And so the legislature also was able to backfill that, so they're not feeling the loss that a 5% tuition cut would be. But that's a critical area. We could pass all of the money we want to get great projects going, but if we don't educate our kids to take those great jobs that Linda was talking about, we're in trouble in this country. And so that's really my next push, is to get more embedded in higher education. But it was a wonderful experience. I learned a lot. 2,200 bills teaches you a little bit about everything. And I can't say I'm an expert on anything, but it was a good way to learn. Thank you.
Well, I too want to thank everyone. Certainly, thank you for this recognition here today, and also thank you for adopting me and allowing me to come up here and enjoying all this. I, of course, have once again, when my wife learned that I was coming up here, I was given a shopping list for the trip home, which of course requires me to drive on Piedmont right by the way. But I will say, politics, as we all know, is often defined by disagreement, and that's okay to a degree, because there were lots of different ideas about how things should be done, but the The trick is not to allow the things that we disagree on to stop the things that we agree on from moving forward. And fortunately, after a record-breaking year down in Olympia, we also broke some records in terms of the number of things that we were able to accomplish for our communities, and not the least of which are some of these capital budget and transportation budget investments that we were able to talk to and speak to today. And so I'm very excited, because South King County should be more than just a place where our head hits the pillow at night. It should be a place that we can live and work as well, and a place that has culture and vibrancy to it. And I think that through the leadership of the folks that are standing behind me, and certainly the leadership of the individuals that are seated here behind the dais and the folks that are here in this room today, that's the type of South King County that we're capable of growing together. And so I'm very appreciative of this today. I thank the mayor for his great work, and also appreciate the drop in my cell phone bill now that the session is over. So.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Yes, I should say, you know, our lobbyists are, we've got Aaron Flyger. Aaron, where are you? Aaron Flyger, would you stand up and let's give everybody a round of applause. Is Martin Durkin here? Okay, right. He did yeoman's duty as well. These guys just work, you know, night and day. We get phone calls all the time. I should tell you, everybody, that when we were talking about the life-saving awards, there's a person here that is in charge of water safety and supervises the lifeguard program. Craig, why don't you stand up, if you could. Just tell us a little bit about what you do, what your interaction with the lifeguards is, and how important water safety is.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor Farrell, Deputy Mayor Burbidge, Council, staff. It's appropriate that Senator Fain be here while I do this topic, and I won't embarrass him by telling him what the date was, because I can't remember what it was. Senator Fain was one of my lifeguarding students a very long time ago, and I certainly hope that some of the conflict resolution skills he learned as a lifeguard have served him well in Olympia. I'm here tonight to briefly talk about water safety programs that we offer within the city and our lifeguarding program. Since 2003, when the City of Federal Way officially adopted an aquatics program into their parks program, the main mission has been promote water safety throughout the community. One of the most visible programs that we offer is the Learn to Swim program. Since we moved into the Federal Way Community Center, we have more than 2,000 students a year go through our program. In this program, participants learn how to swim safely. They learn how to self-rescue themselves and do basic rescue skills when things don't go as planned. 4 years ago, a scholarship fund was adopted and funded through swimathon activities that we do at the community center to help offset costs for people who would not be able to afford to take the swim lessons. To date, more than 100 families have used these funds to get swim lessons for kids that otherwise would not have been able to afford them. Since 2003, more than 350 students have passed our lifeguarding programs, several of which have gone on to work for us, several of the other have not. They've gone to work for other agencies, such as the King County Aquatic Center, who also offers programs, Marine Hills, Twin Lakes. Some have taken these lifeguarding programs only so that they can be a service to their own families when they're camping or out and about. So our reach is far out in the community and other areas in the state. Unfortunately, during the past 2 years, there's been a decrease in interest in becoming a lifeguard. The trend has been noticed throughout the country, and it is serious. Many experts theorize the reason for this decrease in interest is due to the level of responsibility that lifeguards must carry. There is no other job in this country where people of this age are responsible for other people's lives. We are very fortunate in this city to have a dedicated lifeguarding crew that is well-trained, well-motivated, and work under very challenging situations. I would liken our program to the police program, where nobody appreciates us until we're needed. We're a hindrance to them having fun until they're called on to action. This picture up here is an average day at Steel Lake. During this heat wave that we've had much higher attendance. Guards have been out in the sun for an hour and a half at a time with a short break afterwards in 90 degree heat, watching probably 200 to 300 people in the water. Our average attendance for a summer is more than 9,000 people visiting our beach. This summer, we're going to eclipse that probably by the end of July with the number of people that have been coming through. I'd like to recognize not only the two lifeguards that were involved with the rescues, but I'd also like to recognize some of my other staff that are here in attendance. Go ahead and stand up, gang. They put in a long day today. They were out at 9 o'clock this morning training with the South King Fire and Rescue on how we can better incorporate our techniques into their techniques and their techniques into our techniques. We're better off for that training, and they're better off for having our experienced staff work with them. Thank you for this opportunity to talk about our program, and come visit our beach sometime.
Thank you, Greg. And thank you for the work you do. And we also have Doug Nelson here, who runs the community center. Hi, Doug. Thank you very much for the work you do. Great facility.
Can I add something?
Oh, please. Yes.
Yes. And I want to say thank you for the scholarship opportunity, because several years ago, in August of 2012, Topiak and Losotu from Federal Way High School, who also was on the track team, and my son's friend drowned at Steel Lake, and he didn't know how to swim. And so to have the scholarship available to families that can afford to encourage and send their kids for swimming lessons, this is just a great opportunity, and I just want to say thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Southern Austin. Okay, thank you very much. All right, now we have a very special guest with us. Judge Dave Larson is here, and we have our municipal court art winner, Austin May. So, Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Council. About a month ago, we made the awards for the 2014-2015 recipients of the Municipal Court Art Contest. There was one very special recipient that couldn't make it. He was first place in the elementary category. Plus, he went to my alma mater, Mirror Lake Elementary. So that's a very
Yay.
Special. So, and his name's Austin May. He's going to be going into Sahali next year, which I said I'd forgive him because I went to Sacagawea. But Sahali didn't exist in any way. But what I have here is Austin's picture. It's already been hanging in the court. And why don't you come up, Austin? And so what we're going to do is make sure Austin's recognized. He was in the hospital last time. That's why he couldn't make it. So we want to make sure he's recognized for being first place in the elementary school.
So congratulations, Austin.
Put him on the spot. So, thank you very much. And for those that don't know the Municipal Court Art Contest, it's been around for about 6 years. The theme is liberty and justice for all, because you can't have one without the other. And all the artwork for the recipients are 2014-15 hang in the lobby. And then for previous years, those that did not want their, that wanted to keep their art there, it's hung up through the courthouse, through the courtrooms and and other locations. So it's a very good program, and thank you very much for the Arts Commission for sponsoring and for judging the awards.
Well, thank you, Your Honor, and Austin, congratulations. Austin, can I ask a favor? Do you have that your picture in your hands? Would you hand this to Councilmember Duclo, and we're going to pass it all the way down so we can get a good look at it. Oh, yeah, good idea.
After this, Austin gets a special treat, I think, depends on how you look at it. The other recipients had got a tour of the court and got to sit in the judge's chair with a robe on. He'll be able to get a personal tour one-on-one, and he'll be able to be in my robe. If they might need search and rescue to be able to find him, but he'll be able to go down and have his picture taken on the bench and take a tour of the entire courthouse. And so that's where we're going to head now.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, great job. Thank you. Okay. Now we've got certificates of appointment and reappointments. Youth Commission, Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. At the July 7th meeting, the council appointed Jesse Goldstone, Robert McFarlane, and Jillian Ori as voting members of the Youth Commission, and Elizabeth Sandstedt and Connor Bronson-Daugherty as alternate members of the Youth Commission. I'd like to invite these commissioners to please come forward to the podium, and I will read the certificates of appointment and present them. So if you're here, come up to the podium. Certificate of appointment. In accordance with Ordinance 14-774, the City of Federal Way Mayor and the City Council certifies that Robert McFarlane is hereby reappointed to serve as a voting member of the Federal Way Youth Commission for a term to expire August 31st of 2017, signed by the mayor and all seven council members. Also, you're Connor, right?
Yes.
Certificate of appointment. In accordance with Ordinance 14-774, the City of Federal Way Mayor and City Council certifies Connor Bronson-Daugherty is hereby appointed to serve as an alternate member of the Federal Way Youth Commission for a term to expire August 31st of 2017. And you're Elizabeth, right?
Yeah.
Certificate of appointment. In accordance with Ordinance 14-774, the City of Federal Way Mayor and City Council certifies that Elizabeth Sandstedt is hereby appointed to serve as an alternate member of the Federal Way Youth Commission for a term to expire August 31st of 2017. I'd like to congratulate you and thank you for stepping forward to volunteer. We look forward to the work you're going to do as commissioners, and we're very excited to have you on the team.
Okay, Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. I wanted to say congratulations to Elizabeth and to Connor. And I must say, Mr. Mayor, that I am really excited to see Connor step up and apply for this because back in my AmeriCorps days, he was my former student for a year or two, I think. And my classrooms, I would always talk about getting involved in your community, and it's really exciting to sit here and see one of my former students take that initiative and really become active in our community. And I really, of course, want to take the time to also thank all of our other youths that are involved in our community as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Certificate of Appointments, Human Services Commission, Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. At the July 7th meeting, the council appointed Michael,
Pelliciotti.
Okay, well, that's two different, but you know him best. Yeah. So. And Ken Stark is alternate members of the Human Services Commission. I know Michael's here. Would you like to come to the podium, please? And I will read the certificate of appointment now. Certificate of appointment. In accordance with Ordinance 96-281, the City of Federal Way Mayor and City Council certifies Michael Pelliciotti is hereby appointed to serve as an alternate member of the Federal Way Human Services Commission for a term to expire January 31st. Of 2018. We thank you very much and appreciate your service.
Michael, would you like to say a few words?
I just want to thank the council for this opportunity. We actually had our first meeting I had the opportunity to be a part of at the Human Services meeting last night, and it really is just a great commission with really talented individuals, and I'm looking forward to working with them. Thank you.
Michael and I are former co-workers at the King County Prosecutor's Office, and now you're at the Attorney General's Office, correct? That's great.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you for your service. Thank you. Okay, Certificate of Appointment, Lodging Tax Advisory Committee, Deputy Mayor Burbage.
Thank you very much. At our last council meeting, Richard Song, the manager of the Comfort Inn, was appointed as the newest member of the Lodging Tax Advisory Committee, and unfortunately he was not able to be here this evening, but he will be provided with this certificate of appointment to serve as a voting member of the Federal Way Lodging Tax Advisory Committee for a term to expire October 31st, 2015.
Right. Okay. All right, now we'll move on to a mayor's emerging issues and report. We'll have a community development quarterly update. Michael Morales.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. Michael Morales, community development director. We have started to look at the value of providing you with some additional information on the performance of the Community Development Department, which I was appointed by Mayor Farrell to take the helm of in April of this year. And I think it's important that the mayor as well has agreed, because community development is a very good indicator of trends in your community and also a good indicator of your responsiveness to local government. As we look at revenue and projecting now, you're on a two-year budget, it's good to keep track of trends and try to ask questions moving forward. And so we would like to do this for you on a quarterly basis. At this point, this will be a mid-year report for 2015. And also take a look back and see how we ended up in 2014 in the first year of the administration and compared to where we were at the end of 2013. Just to review for you, we have 25 and a half employees at the City of Federal Way providing services in current and long-term land use planning, shoreline and critical areas planning, code enforcement and compliance, building plan review, construction, and electrical inspections, which is unique for a city to do. Typically, it's done by labor and industries, building and land use permits, and we're also a designated passport office by the U.S. Department of State. We have different ways of performing or of measuring our performance from not just numbers of customers, but even the average wait time we have at the service counter, number of permit applications versus number of approvals, our clearance rate, so to speak, passport applications processed, evaluation of permits issued, the number of code complaints and code case clearance rates, which we're currently in the process of refining that because there's a couple different ways at which code violation cases come to us. The types of permits issued by us in their land use or administrative decisions, which are basically over-the-counter, done by myself and the planning manager or staff. SEPA determination, shoreline and stream buffer intrusions and subdivision. For building, we do structural, plumbing, mechanical, electrical, and signage. For this year in 2015, at the midpoint, as of June 30th, we have assisted over 2,600 customers at the counter and over another 3,600 assisted via telephone. Now, there may be folks that call in, get clarification, and we end up assisting with a permit application later, but that's a quite a busy office and a beehive of activity, as you can probably imagine. We've also helped customers via email over 600 times. The average wait time at the counter for customers at the permit center is 4.26 minutes, which is, I think, very, very good, considering we have three permit or development specialists that handle the permit center. We'll call in planners or other members of Public Works who are needed for a particular question. And the way we track that is when you come into the permit center, you sign in, your time signed in. When our staff comes to help you, they indicate that time on the log, so we're able to track that. And that really has stayed in that 4.5 to 5 minute range. I have not seen it over 5 minutes as I've looked back historically at the data. Also, in terms of what we have processed application, 167 land use permit applications, 1,979 building permit applications, which resulted in over 1,600 building permits issued, 315 code violation orders have been responded to, 549 graffiti locations have been abated, and that's not counting the large fence painting projects that that we undertook. 1,756 passports have been issued, which has resulted in almost $44,000 of revenue. That's important to note because we have made adjustments in how we are issuing passports, and we are gone to an appointment-only office versus just walk-ins. And when we've looked at that performance, it actually has been able to keep pace with where we've been. But the difference is that I am only needing to utilize one staff person to manage appointments all day long, whereas before we get backed up, we'd have up to three people deployed at the passport office alone. And we're only generating enough revenue, even at our peak years, to cover about the cost of one position with passports. So that was a very important change for us to make this year. And thus far, we have generated over $1.3 million in total permit revenue for the department. Compared to how we have performed since the time that Mayor Farrell came in 2014 and our year-end totals in 2013, the number of customers assisted has gone up by nearly 1,000. Customers assisted by telephone has gone up by a couple of hundred. Land use applications have gone up slightly. Permit applications have increased by over 400. Permits issued, again, also still on the same clip. Passports issued decreased slightly in 2014, but at this year's pace, we could end up at well over 3,000 passports issued. Code violation orders have increased, 327 to 461 in 1 year alone. By this year's count, we could also basically shatter that number moving forward. And graffiti abatements have also gone up significantly from 649 in 2013 to 843 in 2014. So if you look at where we're at with graffiti right now, we'll be over 1,000 in 2015, and code violations well over 600. Now, when I told you we like to look at what these things measure, what these issues measure, and how we try to read the community trends, the immediate reaction is to say, well, our problems are getting worse in Federal Way. But that's not necessarily the case. In my opinion, and what I have looked at in terms of how we have been deploying our resources, and now that we are just almost fully staffed as a department, we've got one more position to hire, we're being very particular about who we're hiring. You also have, I think, a perception now that's growing where you have a more responsive government. And when you have a more responsive government, people see that you are following through and you are being held accountable. They are more likely to pick up that phone and make that call. It doesn't mean that you get government on demand. You know, one thing that does occur, and I would like to clarify, is that when we get an email from a constituent or a citizen action request, and you may be copied on it, that does not mean they go to the front of the line. We have a process. The only way we can manage this kind of a workload coming at us with three code enforcement officers, two part-time graffiti abatement techs, three permit specialists, is that we have to follow a process. We have to put things in the order they came in. It may take us a couple of weeks to get to a code violation, which is partially why we looked at reducing the grass and weed height sizes when we brought that to you in May, because the problem would only get worse if we were allowing things to grow before we would take a complaint on it. And also where you see revenue is heading, We had nearly $900,000 increase in revenue in the first year of the administration in 2014 versus in 2013. And so sometimes that responsiveness can lead to additional revenue coming in, not always by fines, but by people's desire to invest in your community. We do see that at the current clip, we'd be about $2.6 million if it was just spot on, exactly the same pace going to the rest of the year. But the reality is, right now, until the end of September and October, is peak building time. We get this wave of permit applications that come in for a lot of building activity in the later months of the summer. That doesn't correspond with the quarterly measurement calendar that we're looking at here now. So I'm pretty confident that when we see things, we're going to end up catching what our budget projections are for revenue for the department by the end of this year. So with that, I would open up to any questions you have on the performance of our department. I look forward to bringing this good news, I believe, back to you on a quarterly basis.
Councilmember Duclos.
I don't have a question. I want to thank you very much for the report, and I'd like to wonder if the council could get a copy of that.
Absolutely. Michael, will you please make sure you send that electronically to the council? Oh, Stephanie's on that. All right, great. Thank you. Councilmember Moore?
Mr. Mayor, thank you so much. This is, I don't know where to start, but I'll make it really short. And that's, this report is amazing. Something tells me that we've never done this before. Is that correct?
We're charting new territory.
Exactly. So the reason why, and these are just comments, and really, and I'm going to end with a thank you. And that's the reason why this is so important, and the reason why I really appreciate this is now we have something to start with, and now we're looking for continuous improvements. And clearly, there's a lot of demand, according to the numbers, that we're seeing coming out of the community development. And I think there's a lot of room for opportunities. There's a lot of room for continuous improvement opportunities. And I think, and I would continue to encourage the mayor to look at, take it to the next level, look at lean management, implementing practices of lean management into that community development department, phase it in, you know, whatever it is, because I know it's a controversial issue. And I think that's really important. I think efficiency is a great thing, and that's important. So really, I'll just end it by saying thank you. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for putting the numbers together. And thank you to the staff and to the mayor's office for looking for ways to improve so that we can produce the best possible results for our neighbors, our business leaders, and our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Honda.
Thank you very much. I have two questions. One, about how long would it take for a person to get a building permit for a single family home? And two, with the report about the big earthquake that's going to happen, which I grew up all my life hearing about the big earthquake that's going to happen, are there things that people can do structurally to make their homes safer in Federal Way that we could be encouraging?
Don't make improvements to your house without a permit and a licensed and bonded and insured contractor. That's the best advice I can give you for making your house safer. And that is a chronic issue in Federal Way that we run into are a number of homes that have had significant changes made without permits over the years. I understand it's a young city. Part of that goes back to the times in county. But we're facing a lot of that now as it converts to illegal conversions from single family to multifamily, office buildings to apartments. And sometimes I've had a case where a tenant themselves is the one that had to turn in their landlord because they had an unsafe condition that wasn't being corrected. And unfortunately, it resulted in people being displaced because none of those units were legal, and with or without a permit. So that's the main thing, is to make sure that you're following those rules, because if that, you know, what do they say to do is get under a door jam. If that door jam is put in there by somebody who didn't know what they were doing, or you had no structural permit to even know if it's going to hold anything up, you may not, maybe making the matter worse. As far as how long it takes to get a permit, people don't always understand this part of it, but a permit processing is really about a matter of how complete an application is. And so we get into single family residence, whether it's a brand new house or an improvement being made to the facility. If those are complete plans that are brought in, it's done over the counter practically. It's very quick. What happens a lot of times is architects bring in incomplete plans. They want us to complete them for them. We can't do them. The owner wonders where his permit is, and we get a call, and we are honest with the owner and say, if your architect will finish X, Y, and Z on those plans, we can get this thing done. So that it really is a matter of completeness, and we're always willing to work with people over the counter to answer questions. You know, we have to be careful about crossing the line where we're doing too much and putting ourselves in a position of liability, but if plans are complete and you start with following the rules from the get-go, it really is not very challenging to get a single-family house permit for just about anything.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All right, Council, any other questions? All right, thank you, Michael. Great job. That's big news about that $900,000 increase in 1 year, so that's good to know. All right, now, Councilmember Roselski for the recognition of Public Works Department.
Yes, thanks, Mayor Farrell, and I can see it's going to be a tough act to follow Director Morales on the presentation he just made, but I'll give it my best. Thank you, Michael. So just a few minutes ago, we recognized our state legislators for the hard work that they achieved to bring state funds to the city for the PAEC and the other projects that they brought in for the other parts of the legislative district. And I know we all appreciate the efforts that and the results that they brought in. So along those lines, I want to recognize the Department of Public Works. For about the past 3.5 years, I've chaired the Land Use and Transportation Committee, serving along with many of my colleagues on the dais here on that particular committee. And during those meetings, we do a lot of things. We review and analyze projects involving right-of-way design, bid, and construction. We review important projects, such as our wonderful asphalt overlay program, the care of our surface water and our drainage systems, and upgrades to our roads and our traffic control. We review interlocal agreements with other government agencies to help care for the environment and for our surroundings. And we recently reviewed the comprehensive master plan, which steers the efforts of the city going forward for a better future. So this is just a small example of what the committee sees. In the consent agenda tonight, we're going to shortly vote on exactly 10 items that went to this meeting from the Public Works Department alone. So the committee's job is simple, really, compared to the complexity and the hard work of the members of the Department of Public Works. This group of professionals does so much for all of us in the city, which results that make a huge difference in our lives. And they do it oftentimes without recognition in what can be a thankless, pressure-packed job. So going back to our legislators bringing in funds to help the city, the Department of Public Works is constantly hunting for, finding, and submitting proposals to bring in funds for the various projects that they work on. And some are huge, multi-million dollar projects, and some are small projects in scope. But the funds that they bring in are impressive. And over the years that I've been involved with the committee, I've been able to see some of this. So I asked Director Saloom to give me some data, show me what exactly that they've done. And he did. He gave me a spreadsheet with different projects over the past 20 years. And it's impressive. So what they've accomplished, just a few examples, $1.5 million in funds for phases 2 and 3 of the BPA trail, which is that beloved trail that that so many thousands of residents use in the south end of the city and through the to the city center. They brought in $91 million in funds from state and other agencies for Pacific Highway South road improvements, which is, of course, improved traffic flow, utility effectiveness, and added a measure really of beauty to that arterial, which was formerly cluttered with power lines and unsightly other signs. They brought in about $1.6 million for the yellow light safety project, the flashing yellow lights that we've seen emerge here the past few years. And I'm certain every driver in the city has benefited from the time savings of those lights, and also better safety from their efforts. These are just a few of the projects that they've brought in external money on. So in review over the course of the past 20 years or so, the department project leads have brought in over $136 million into the city for these projects, which represents about 60% of the total cost of these projects. And all, of course, going to improve our city's infrastructure. So one area that the city spends its own funds with no contribution from the state is our annual asphalt overlay program. In 20 years, the city has funded $31 million to keep the streets smooth and, of course, pothole free. So that's over $1.5 million annually, giving us really the best surfaces to drive on in the state. And that program, I know, will continue. I don't think anybody would dare get in the way of that one. It's just such a great thing for our city. So really, it's been a pleasure. It's been my pleasure to work with Marwan Saloom, the director, and his outstanding staff, and previously with Director Carrie Rowe, who of course has left the city. But it's been my pleasure to see firsthand the difference that they have all made in improving our city and our lives. So as chair of the LUTC, I want to thank you on behalf of the City of Federal Way, the Department of Public Works. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Okay, now moving on, we have actually a big development in regard to the Sound Transit Preferred Alignment. The vote by the Sound Transit Board will occur this Thursday, the 23rd, at their Seattle offices. I believe it's the King Street Station. It's going to be I believe at 1:30 in the afternoon on that Thursday. We'll be there and making sure that your voice is heard and that all the South Sound cities' voices are heard. So stay tuned for that preferred alignment for the Federal Way Link Light Rail update. This Friday, we've got the traditional salmon bake at Steel Lake Park from 4 to 8 p.m. on this Friday, the July 24th. Great opportunity to be there, and you can just see how beautiful it is there. We've got National Night Out on August 4th. One of the reasons I'm talking about this is we're going to change the schedule of our council meetings in August. We normally do not have a second meeting in August. We cancel just by tradition, and because of giving people the opportunity for vacations, the meeting in the third week of August. But the first meeting in August has always been coinciding with National Night Out. So we're moving our council meeting to the 11th, and that way we can all attend the National Night Out, and would encourage people in their communities to go out for these festivities and really connect with their neighborhoods. And we'll be the chief and I and members of the council and members of the community are going to be going around to these individual locations. So watch out for that. Okay, so now for the most important part of the evening, citizen comment. I believe everybody knows the rules. They were printed on the pink sheets when you filled them out. Joanne Paquette, who is, speaking for more than five people. So let's make sure that Ms. Paquette gets 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, and members of the council. This is an update from the Federal Way Coalition of the Performing Arts on fundraising activities for the PAC. We have just created new naming opportunities in the facility for donors with a wide range of prices. We're hoping those who have been considering a contribution will check out the list and description and be interested in having their name on something. Forms are on the back table. And we've already had someone select the elevator. So Friday, we will have an informational booth at the Kiwanis Salmon Bake. On Sunday, the 26th, we will be holding a fundraising event at KOAM-TV. And the Federal Way Youth Symphony Orchestra and the Federal Way Chorale will be performing. More details are on the invitations on the table by the door, and Teresa Yvonne will be doing a presentation about the PAC. And Sherry Song, Rick Kong, and Mike Park have been key organizers of this. We will be doing presentations on the PAC at service clubs, starting with Rotary on Thursday, and a noon Kiwanis meeting in August. The grant committee has been developing plans to contact many businesses throughout the area and encouraging participating through donating. They will be some of the first to see the new naming opportunities. Up until now, our focus has been on individuals who have contributed a total of $705,938. We have pledges for an additional $71,000. Most of the pledges will be paid later this year. We will be transferring all these funds to the city in August, and by then we hope to have even more. And now I would like to offer some information on the potential tourism aspect of the PAEC. In June, I joined a tour of 73 people to go to Branson, Missouri. We were all interested in musical theater, but had little knowledge of the city itself. Most of us thought Branson focused on country western music. That was true many years ago, but they have evolved to be the live show entertainment capital of the world. Here are some facts about this city of 10,500 residents that I thought would be helpful for developing tourism in Federal Way. Branson is now based on drawing tourists to the town's entertainment industry. Years ago, they started promoting it as a resort town with street fairs, parades, community picnics, and boat races. Then several artists and performers began settling there, some building their own theaters. It kept growing and developing seasonal themes. To be able to accommodate the 100,000 visitors each day, hotels and restaurants were built too. And so now they have 151 hotels and 331 restaurants. I couldn't believe all this. It was amazing. They offer 100 live shows a day starting at 10:30 a.m. We saw two shows a day, eight in the restaurants, which could handle our large group, and one day saw three shows, including showboat cruise. They have one-of-a-kind museums and theme parks, golf courses, plus train rides through the Ozarks with lunch or dinner. Just about any kind of entertainment imaginable, all family-friendly. And they also have a zip line. I didn't try that. Imagine our large group and the money we left there. Of course, we went souvenir shopping, and almost all the theaters had souvenir shops. There was a lot of cross promotion. A shopping center had A-board signs that read, "Save your receipts totaling $100 and receive a show ticket." We could do that with tickets to various attractions in Federal Way. Most people would then buy at least one more ticket. Branson is 20.8 square miles, similar to Federal Way. They didn't create this overnight, but with our new Performing Arts and Events Center, with the many activities there, we can also cross-promote many other local attractions, become a major destination city too. They did it. Why not us? Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Perfect timing. All right, Norma Blanchard.
Good evening. I'm Norma Blanchard, longtime rep.
Oh. Take two.
I'm Norma Blanchard, longtime resident of Federal Way, and I have a request. Now, we've had two initiatives in the city, and we had one voting in last November, and we've got another one coming up this November on the marijuana. So I would like to have a report on how much each initiative cost and how much either the two that went on to the November ballots. Because I keep hearing it's so expensive for the initiative, so that the people were taken out of the picture, that we could only vote one time instead of on in the primaries. So how about giving me a report written, please? Thank you.
All right, thank you, Norma. I mean, Joe, we'll talk about this, about seeing if we can find some easily ascertainable figures, and perhaps at the next city council meeting. Or Ms. Blanchard, would it be okay to do wait till the next city council meeting, or you want to just mail you that? Would you like us to mail you that report, or to report it at the next city council meeting?
Yeah, mail it to you. Email.
Sounds good. We'll do that. Thank you very much. Okay, Monty Kotelek. Cotilla, excuse me.
Is it okay if I don't use the mic?
I think it helps for purposes of, yeah.
For the record. We need you to, for the record.
Please.
Well, you can't grab it either.
No.
I'm sorry, I'm new at this. I've never been to a council meeting, and but I'll introduce myself. And the purpose of my being here is in opposition to what's going, what's planned to be done. My understanding is there is a vote tonight that the council is going to make in my residence area. I live at 3232 Southwest 326th Street, as you can see. Now, the reason I'm here is that I'm passionate about safety. Nobody that I know of is more passionate about safety than I. Ray Gross is one of my bosses. I work with CERT and CAT. I'm up here for a lot of training. I've been involved with several different churches. But my background is that I started my vocation in Montana at a local 459. And so that means eventually I became a plumbing, heating, mechanical contractor. And then I taught people how to put in sewer waters, all kinds of stuff. So I don't know what I haven't done. I retired from Boeing. I know more about safety because I trained safety at Boeing, and I'm frustrated with the plan that is presented. It's not a good plan. I've been involved in several of the meetings regarding that, the speed bumps and the circular drive about that they intend to install. Now, I tried to get some of our neighbors to come, but some of them are crippled up, can't make it. They've got meetings. And unfortunately, some of them think that coming here and talking about it won't make any difference, will not bring common sense to our community. So if the issue, and I invite any council member, anybody here, to walk the grounds with me, and I'll tell you why this will not work. I know what I'm talking about. I live in this area. I work with the security, Twin Lake Security. I'm the guy who sits up at night and listens. I walk the neighborhood, I drive the neighborhood. I've been in this neighborhood for 20 some years. So I know what's gonna, am I done?
No, 30 seconds.
Okay.
We'll let you finish, Monty, go ahead.
So the point being, this design is gonna be a serious mistake. And it's my taxpayer money, and yours as well. It will fail. So if you would respectfully put a hold on it, come meet with me. I'll build the case. I've got 6 seconds left. I'm done.
All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. We'll be in touch. I'm going to ask a couple of questions here, and we'll be in touch with you. Right, Monty?
We have my phone number, right?
We do. Right here. I got it. Thank you very much. And your address. Marwan, any kind of, why don't we go through the rest of the public comments, and then we'll come back to Marwan. So, Monty, you may want to stick around for a few minutes, because at the very end of public comment, I'm going to have Marwan address this issue, okay?
I won't help. I've already talked to you.
All right. Thank you. Mary Menard. And then after that, Betty Taylor. And then Miss Nancy Combs. And then, okay, go ahead. Evening.
Good evening. Hi, I'm Mary Menard, and I'm speaking to address item 5C on the agenda, which is the Twin Lakes neighborhood traffic safety item. The main intersection of interest for me is Southwest 325th Street and 35th Avenue Southwest, and this is illustrated in tonight's meeting packet on page 20. Perhaps we can show it. That is a very dangerous intersection because of the topography and also because of the speeding traffic. It is my personal experience as a driver and as a pedestrian that most of the traffic coming through there is speeding and does not stay in its assigned lane.
Right.
I'm very pleased with the proposal to add lane dividers, which is 1B. On the illustration in the packet. I feel that this will improve the safety for drivers, pedestrians, and probably also the residents. I also am pleased with the proposal at Site 3 to go with the traffic circle at Southwest 327th Street and 35th Avenue Southwest. This is an intersection which is being controlled by unnecessary stop signs in the sense they're unnecessary to have traffic yield to each other. They do provide traffic calming, but there's a danger where drivers assume that they're just stopping to stop, and they stop looking for traffic coming the other way because there virtually never is any. But then that one morning at 8:30 when there's a car coming the other way, they're not really looking. And they stop, but they don't really think about yielding. They just think, I have to stop before I can go. And so if we went with the traffic circle, flow would be improved. We wouldn't have unnecessary braking and accelerating, but I think safety would improve as well, which is my main point. I'd also like to commend Eric Preston, the traffic engineer who's been working on this. I think he's done a professional job. I think he's made a quality proposal. From my perspective, not as a resident who's looking for traffic calming because I live on those streets, but as a resident in the area who uses it as a driver and a pedestrian, I would like to recommend that you approve this proposal. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mary. And you may want to stick around as well because I think we're going to talk about this a bit. All right. All right, Betty Taylor, then Nancy Combs, and then Igor, go ahead, Betty. Hi.
Hi. Okay. as like a lot of recognitions were like given tonight and stuff, and so like I was listening to the one about the swimmers, you know, and the lifeguards and stuff, and I think that's out of that. I think that. To me, it seemed like something was missing out of that whole scenario. I feel like it's good to give recognition, you know, to the lifeguards and to the people that were involved in the savings of lives. But what about the people whose lives were saved? I think to me that part was missing. And I would have loved to see them talk about their experience, you know, just like the mother of the kids or even the kids themselves, not just the lifeguards, but those that were basically involved, those that had, that it really made an impact on. So, you know, and then I was thinking it would be good also to, like even if the newspaper, you know, do an article on the, on not just a life saving, but whose life was saved and the impact it made on the people whose lives were saved, the children that were involved, the families that were involved, get a statement from each one, because it really makes a difference in this community. Also, let me see, where I've been living, I'm living for a long time and stuff, and so like, lately we've been having a lot of police activity, and I wonder about that. I wonder about the, there was this one particular apartment complex that was just infested with drugs, and people were like coming in and out, constantly in and out, and it was almost like nobody cared. I mean, you know, when I went to management about it, you know, they weren't really talking, you know, they were like hush hush, you know, they were saying, well, we're doing this, we're doing that, but it just took too long. It just took too long, and it just took too long, and it was drag out and drug out, and to me, I don't know, that for me as a resident, that impacted me. It impacted my life because I had to go to the apartment complex every single day and had to be witness, you know, to the corruption, you know, which shouldn't even be, and it should, there should be an end to it. There should be a stop to it. It should, I mean, I think that apartment complex, there should be an end to stuff like that. People shouldn't have to witness stuff like, it's just awful. My time is up, and so, but anyway, I just want to speak on those issues.
Thank you, Betty, and it's a good point about the other side of the equation on the life-saving. We'll think about that. Sometimes there are, it can be a little complicated, but we'll think about that next time, okay? Thank you for the great idea. Okay, Nancy Combs.
council, mayor, and people, let me tell you what I have lived on 21st Avenue for 50 or 60 years. My kids went to school at Adelaide, but it has changed, and it is a busy intersection at 304th and 21st Avenue. Someone's going to be killed. You would not. I have petitions right here in the bag for years, and you've signed against it. I know who you are, and you signed against safety. It should not be. People are that live down at the beach, they come up, and then here's 21st over here. There should be a stop sign over here to stop that beach people. And then my street now is like a freeway. It's not a freeway. It is a neighborhood road. And this past week, there was three fires right across from my house on the bank right next to the road. Three fires. It's black. And if it had flown over, if it had been any of it, it could have burned my house down. Now, I want to know what's going on. And in every block, my block, the next block, and that one, there is businesses running right there in those homes, and no one's doing nothing about it. I see them at night because I can see it. And there are strangers. I live alone. I don't want strangers. And in front of my house, what did the city do to us? They dumped gravel right up in front of our houses. And now weeds are growing up in front of the gravel. So I had to go to the store and buy stuff to spray the gravel. You didn't do it. I had to do it up and down the street. That's what they're doing to us. And people are walking on those curbs. There's big white curbs in front of my house. Thanks a lot. A bunch of junk out there. And they're riding bikes on those big white curbs. That's a bunch of, you know what? It's terrible what you've done. And down on 336, someone was killed. Did you know that at Dairy Queen a year or two ago? A driver was killed down there. We've waited for a stop sign. And what have they done? They put a one-way stop down there. All of my big businesses know how bad it is. And they have told me about it, not my idea. It was all the big businesses. One way, coming from Fred Meyer, you come across the street, they're in the right lane, they said, oh, I wanted to be in the left lane, so they cut you off. Something's got to be done before there's an accident there. You got to have a four-way stop. I go to KFC, I go to Jack in the Box, right across there. You cannot turn left up to Fred Meyer's or to the post office. No, you can't do it. You are just, this city is sick, I'll tell you that. And I can tell you all the things. We need these petitions signed, but you signed against safety. And it's enough what you've done to us.
All right, thank you, Nancy.
After 50 years, it's too much.
All right, thank you, Nancy. Okay, we have Igor Melissa-Menlio. Sorry for the pronunciation. Igor, how do you say that?
Maximenko.
All right, what you said. All right, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead, sir.
I want to thank you for the opportunity to give me to speak, and I want to address the concern of our neighborhood regarding the speed reduction initiative on 35th Avenue, to which several people have spoken about. And I'm here to support this initiative among the overwhelming majority of neighbors. I live right on that street on 35th Avenue, and I have already emailed several council members noting of an accident that happened late this winter when a car actually flipped over in front of my car, in front of my house, and I was the first one to run out there to call the police, and luckily no one was injured. It actually struck a car that was parked there, which was later, we found out that was totaled completely. And I started this, I gathered these petitions and took advantage of this neighborhood safety program. which I am very thankful for, because I'm not sure of any other city that does such a thing, but you really give an opportunity for citizens and neighborhoods to take some measures in keeping the community safe. And I just want to know, I just want to let you know that I have a 1-year-old boy growing up in my house, and I want him to be in a safe neighborhood. Personally, I really don't like speed bumps myself, and I'm sure many people do not like them, but we do have to take it for the community, for others' safety, and for our children. And pretty much that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Igor. Appreciate it. Okay, are there any other public comments? All right, so we'll move on. I had promised that we're gonna have a presentation, but clearly the item 5C is on for consent. What I would suggest, council, is that we pull item 5C, that we, let's handle the regular consent agenda, and then for consideration of 5C, we'll get a presentation. I presume that's Mr. Preston in the back of the room. But Mr. Preston, do you have a PowerPoint presentation ready? Okay, why don't you do that while we're working on the consent agenda, please? All right, so with that in mind, that I have now pulled item 5C, is there, Deputy Mayor, is there a motion for items 5A and B? Well, why don't I go ahead and read these items, just for the record. 5A is the minutes for the July 7th, 2015 regular and special meetings. Item B is South 356th Street, Pacific Highway South to Enchanted Parkway, improvement projects, 85% status report. Item C is the Twin Lakes 15 Neighborhood Traffic Safety, 35th Avenue Southwest, Southwest 325th to Southwest 327th Street. That item has been pulled. Item D, authorization to enter into an agreement with King County for services related to effectiveness monitoring of the South 356th Street retrofit and expansion project. Item E, authorization to accept the 2016 Water Quality Algae Control Program grant and enter into a grant agreement with the Department of Ecology. Item F, Catch Basin CB rebuild small public works contract. Item G, authorization to enter into an agreement for water resource inventory, WIRA 9. Item H, First Avenue South at South 328th Street intersection improvements bid award. Item I, South 288th Street Preservation Project bid award. Item J, South 324th Street Preservation Project bid award. Item K, resolution, acceptance of transportation grant, Sacagawea Safe Routes to School. Item L, Washington Traffic Safety Commission, amendment number 3 to the October 1, 2014, September 30th, 2015, Memorandum of Understanding, or MOU. Item M, Fiscal Year 2015 Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Grant, JAG. Item N, Town Square Park Bid Award. Out of those items, other than item C, is, Council, is there an item that you would want pulled for separate discussion? All right, that being said, Deputy Mayor Burbidge, do you have a motion?
I do. I move approval of items A and B and items D through N on the consent agenda.
Second.
All right, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of these items?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? These matters passed unanimously. Item C, Twin Lakes. Mr. Preston.
Okay.
All right, please proceed.
Okay. So, just to clarify, would you like me to go through the entire presentation as presented to the Land Use Committee?
Let's go through it in a fairly, you know, good clip, and yeah, hit the highlights.
Okay, so as you see on the map, the original petition was for the blue area along 35th Avenue Southwest between 325th and 327th. Through community meetings, the area got expanded into the yellow areas for consideration because of speeding in those areas, those concerns. The petition was submitted in February. Concerns of speeding, collisions with homes, and actually one of them was with the home of the man who spoke earlier during the commentary.
It scored 3.5 points on the scale, which exceeded the 3 points needed to go continue the process. 85th percentile speeds were over 30 miles an hour, over 2,000 daily cars in that area. Oops. And so there's, you can see a spread out of the dots of the reported collisions during the 5 years that we analyzed. And the red marks where we collected counts. The one dot right here in the lower right is one of those collisions with a home. In fact, the man who did comment earlier. And there's another collision with a home right here at this corner as well. And so there's some restrictions in that area. The red areas are either too steep, too steep or too close to stop signs. And the blue areas, again, are just too steep. But, because we can't put a speed hump or any type of those devices on a place with a grade over 8%. And so we had our first committee meeting March 31st with some good attendance. They wanted a traffic circle, a speed hump, and taking away those stop signs and just doing a two-way stop with a raised crosswalk. There were lots of options, and so there wasn't a clear favorite. So when we went to the ballot, I kind of gave them two options for each location. The intersection with 325th and 35th, they could choose a traffic circle or speed humps and dividers, which eventually won out. Location 2 has a speed hump. Location 3, the intersection of 327th, they could choose a traffic circle or removing some stop signs, adding a raised crosswalk. There's also the option of a speed hump further to the south. The balloting for location 1 showed that the speed humps and dividers were preferred. And I felt these addressed the speeding concerns, the speeds that we saw, as well as the people taking the corner at a very high rate of speed, which caused some of those collisions. Location 2, the speed hump had a very favorable outcome. Location 3, the traffic circle went out by a good margin, and location 4, the speed hump won as well. Then I had held a follow-up meeting June 10th.
Can you go back one? So majority of, with 63 ballots returned, so 34 is a majority. It would take a 51% approval. So
I see what you, there's 63 returned of the 164%. But
right.
Since there were three options for location 1, is that what you're specifically?
I'm just trying to, can you guide us through these election results in regard to?
Sure.
Which one's passed and
sure.
The percentage?
Maybe I'll back up a little bit. Typically, the ballot is yes or no. Do you like this proposal or no?
Right.
In this case, there were different options that would work, but they were divided, as you can see, as far as the opinion. And so locations 2 and 3 and 4 did have not only a majority of the ballots, but also they were the highest rated. Location 1 had the most, option B had the most votes for that location. And that's why it went out, because it had the most votes, had 25 votes. Option A had 23, option C no action at 13.
But out of the 63 returned, only 23 of those people want the traffic circle?
Yeah, only 23 wanted the traffic circle, and 25 wanted the speed humps or dividers.
Oh, sorry. And then in the third area, number 3, you've got a traffic circle with 33.
Exactly.
All right. I'm sorry, Councilmember Honda.
Thank you very much. So between the traffic circle and divider and the speed humps and dividers, as a professional, what was your recommendation?
I have a preference for traffic circles in general, but at a T intersection like this, they're not as effective for one direction, because it's very easy for, in this case, the westbound direction to go straight through the intersection without slowing down very much. And so in this case, I think the speed humps on both sides of the intersection and the lane dividers accomplish the goal that we want probably the best.
Okay, thank you.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, next slide.
Please.
So second community meeting, June 10th at Brigadoon, again, well attended. We chose to remove the speed hump at location 4 because, as was mentioned, there are quite a few speed humps along 35th already. We felt this might be overkill for that section. And so I notified everyone of the ballot results, and there was a generally favorable response. And we began some discussion with the HOA about landscaping within the traffic circle. 327. And so some budget considerations. Annually, there's a $50,000 budget for the NTS, but only $11,000 of it has been currently spent, so there's $39,000 available, and we don't foresee any more large outcomes from that. There is typically $15,000 per neighborhood is allocated. With this project, we're estimating at $25,000, and so we would still have extra remaining in the budget if needed. And so the recommendation was to install the 3 speed humps, the lane dividers, and the traffic circle in this area.
The traffic circle, can you go back where the balloting was, please? Is that the under option 3, the 35th?
Yes. That is correct. At location 3, option A, the traffic circle.
But when you just described it a minute ago, it was at 35th and 325th, not 35th and 327th. Can you go back
on
now?
The last slide, I'm sorry, that was a typo. Yeah.
Okay. So we are talking about 35th. Is the traffic circle 35th and 327th?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question.
Okay, Councilmember Honda.
So the traffic circle that is proposed here, the HOA, are they willing to do the landscape? Now, the city would put the landscaping in, but the HOA must maintain it for 3 to 5 years?
Right. We haven't gotten down to the details yet with the HOA, but yes, they are willing to do that. That's our discussion so far.
My question on that is... the traffic circles on 330th, it looks like a couple of the plants might be in jeopardy of survival. Would the city replace those over as plants come and go, or does the HOA, are they responsible for that?
We have a contractual relationship with, are we talking with the Ridge and West Campus?
For any traffic circles that have landscaping in them?
Yes, with that, they actually, it's a very great arrangement that Marwan and the city have been, have worked with the both the Ridge and West Campus, who came together. I think we agreed on 5 years, is that right?
That's correct, Mayor. We agreed for 5 year where the homeowner association will be maintaining that area. And if there is any plant that need to be replaced, that will be their responsibility to replace. In this particular case at the Ridge, we already in communication with them. One of the plant in their mind that was planted and it was not as healthy as it should be. And I promised them if it did not survive, I may replace that particular plant.
Okay, it's probably the one I've noticed because it doesn't look very good.
Okay, all right.
Just wondering.
No, it's a good point. You know, these are nice relationships to start. We did the same with the traffic circle by Sherwood Forest that Councilmember Duclo had brought to our attention. And these kind of cooperative agreements with the HOAs are a great way to go. Okay, Councilmember Selsky.
Yes, thanks, Mayor Farrell. Thanks, Eric. So the outcome that was the result of the vote, is that what you as a professional would recommend for the best outcome of this?
Yeah. Yes, it is a very good outcome.
Okay. Okay, and you know what, I know I have driven through that area probably for the last 35 years occasionally, and I had high school friends who lived there, so even as a high school student, I drove through that area, and I've seen plenty in there, and I really like this solution as well, and of course the LUTC suggested to move that to the consent agenda, which we, you know, which we pulled off. But anyway, I like the solution as well. So thank you.
Very good. Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. Eric, right?
Yes.
Nice to meet you, Eric. What would your comment, if I may, what would your response be to Monty's concerns?
What were his concerns?
I guess he wasn't pleased with this proposal, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, and that I was going to ask what exactly those concerns were.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Yeah, he did, as you probably saw, he did speak to me afterwards. And so he, I'll try to speak to his concern right now. So he lives, I believe it's this house or one of these two houses right here. And he's concerned about speeding on this, on his street, 326th. In particular, people coming from 325th up 35th and around here very, very fast and doing donuts in this cul-de-sac across the street. And so I feel that this proposal addresses his concern, in part at least, because it restricts speeding around this corner, it restricts speeding over this speed hump, and the study did not extend down his street here. If there is more that we can do here, he's welcome to submit a petition. I'm not opposed to doing more. It's just that 35th was the focus area of our study. But I think what we have here will limit what he's experiencing.
Please.
I'm just going to ask you. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to ask you a dumb question, Eric.
No problem.
So clearly, back in the drawings, there was never any. Obviously, there isn't any speed humps. There's nothing, none of that, which is what's happening. Now, by adding those things, that's going to clearly slow down that person driving the vehicle. Okay.
Yeah.
Just wanted to confirm and make sure.
Sure.
Thank you.
Councilmember Honda and then Safa Dawson.
Eric, years ago, when Silver Lake Elementary was built, I was involved in the PTA there, and we had some safety concerns. And so we worked with King County and got some speed humps up on the main road where it's either 13th or 11th. I think it's 11th. What we found was that people, to avoid those speed humps, went down on 13th where our kids were walking. And we didn't anticipate that, and it was a huge concern. On this area, on 326 where Monty lives, do you anticipate traffic avoiding this traffic circle and the speed humps and driving on 32nd to avoid that?
Well, I suppose it's possible from his immediate neighborhood, but to go.
I'm concerned about making a problem that might not exist today by fixing a problem that does exist.
I understand.
You know, I'll let the traffic. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I mean, he's a professional.
Sure.
You know, I saw it's happened before in other locations, so I'm wondering if it would happen here and cause a problem that maybe not be present at this time.
I could see that happening more with speed humps and those vertical devices especially. But usually a traffic circle is very, it's much more pleasant to drive through. And in this case, it doesn't require a full stop. And so there's a potential it could even reduce their travel time. So I don't see that it would necessarily cause a diversion in the neighborhood.
Okay.
Right, because there's stop signs. Oh, sorry. There's stop signs there now where that traffic circle is projected to be. So anybody who would go around that location would probably already be doing that anyway. So
Councilmember Safa Dawson, then Councilmember Duclos. Okay.
So Monty's house, is it on an incline? Is it a hill where it could increase speed as they're going past this house? Would that be a concern also?
I think there is a slight incline coming down from 32nd down 326, but in front of his house it's relatively level.
Mm-hmm.
That cul-de-sac in front of his house goes up a bit.
Yes.
There's a slight grade up.
And and he's concerned about some younger people doing donuts in that area. I don't know that I can do much about that.
Councilmember Duclos. Oh, were you done?
I was just wondering if that also could be a concern of his, if that's the case, you know, in terms of incline.
Thank you.
I just want to make an observation. For any traffic circle that we put in, we have yield signs, but we need to say yield to traffic entering from the left, because people are always looking to, maybe looking to the right, or don't know. They think they're coming up and they're entering in it, and I called Marwan on that, and he put some over lately. But anytime we put a traffic circle in, put that sign underneath the yield to traffic entering from the left.
I use it every Sunday coming up, whatever that is, by 2 hours. And there's a yield sign right there, and it says yield. Nobody stops. They come around. And they
well, that's what I'm talking about, Nancy. I'm talking about people think they have the right of way when they should be yielding coming up if somebody's already coming into the circle. So it is confusing, so put that bottom sign down there, and it really helps.
All right. Thank you, Councilmember Duclos. I'm getting recognition from Marwan that's an effort in place. All right, Council, any further questions for Mr. Preston? Very good job. Thank you, Eric. Appreciate it. All right. Is there a motion with regard to actually, we've got our land use chair here, Councilmember Selsky. Chair Selsky.
Yes, Mayor Farrell. I move approval of Consent Agenda 5C.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Matter passes unanimously. Great. Thank you very much for coming. Yes, sir. Jim?
I have a question on that, because what I see here on the agenda bill says the policy question, should the council approve the installation of 3 speed humps and 2 lane dividers and 1 traffic circle on 35th Avenue Southwest and Southwest 325th Street?
Jim, can you come up approach that podium real quick? Let's make sure we get this on the record, sir.
Confusion, again, as to where that traffic circle is going to be.
Okay, let's hash that out. This is Jim Stiles. We voted for the, actually let's finish the vote, but we'll clarify here in just a few moments.
Right.
I said all those in favor. Let's do all those in favor.
Aye.
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 Opposed? All right. Now, Jim, please.
Okay, my question again is what the agenda bill says is not what he was talking about. I want to make sure that, because where you want the traffic circle is 327th, that's about 4 blocks from my house. So I go through this one every day. And so you want it at 327th and 35th, but that's not what it says here.
We've noted the Scrivener's error, and it's been changed on the master document.
Okay.
So
I think we're good, Jim. I noticed it, too, when we were going through that. But thank you very much for the clarification.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. All right. But thanks for help. All right. All right. At this time, we're moving on to item 6, council business. I will at this time recognize Councilmember Maloney, who has probably has a great deal of patience being on the phone. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Very good. Of course, we saved all the public presentations for the meeting that you're calling in. So, thank you for your patience.
Well, thank you for accommodating me. I appreciate it.
Okay, I know this issue means a lot to you, so we wanted to make sure we did everything we could. All right, now on to item 6A, the pro-committee appointments for November advisory ballot on retail marijuana. Before we go further, I also want to make sure that it's clear that interviews for these two committees occurred earlier today, starting at 4:30 in this hall, and went on for almost 2 hours, that occurred in the back of the room by the council, of which Councilmember Maloney appeared telephonically, also from out of state. So she was present telephonically present during those interviews. I want to make sure the record is clear there. So in regard to the pro committee appointments for November advisory ballot on retail marijuana, Deputy Mayor Burbridge, do you have a motion?
I do. I move to appoint Elise Crick, Francois Reif, and Cristiano Suzuki as leaders of the PRO committee and direct the city clerk to report these committee members to King County elections.
Second.
Okay. Those names that have been identified by the deputy mayor, and there's been a motion and a second. Is there a discussion on that, on the motion and the second? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? All right. The matter passes unanimously. Item B, CON committee appointments for November advisory vote on retail marijuana. Deputy Mayor Burbridge.
I move to appoint Jack Walsh, Jim Stiles, and Terry Thomas II as leaders of the CON committee and direct the city clerk to report these committee members to King County elections.
Second.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. We have ourselves some committees. Thank you very much for their willingness. Council, thank you very much for the great degree of work that you did and attention to detail. Councilmember Maloney, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are you going to remain on the phone, or are you going to leave us at this time?
I am leaving you because we are driving 2 hours to the airport right now, so I'm in the car. So
all right.
I'll be getting off. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Okay. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Councilmember Honda.
Mayor, everyone who was on the list who applied is also on the committee. Their
Thank
names
you.
Just won't be listed in the brochure.
Thank you. I forgot to say that. I appreciate it. That's a very important point. Deputy Mayor Burbridge.
And additionally, I've wanted to make clear that it's possible for other folks to participate as well if there is interest.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, regional coordination framework for disasters and planned events. Staff report by Ray Gross, Emergency Management Coordinator.
Good evening, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, members of the council. I bring before you tonight a policy question that has gone through the Parks, Recs, Human Services, Public Safety Committee. The policy question is, should the City of Federal Way sign the Regional Coordination Framework for Disasters and Planned Events? What I'd like to do is just provide some brief background and then address any concerns or questions. The Regional Coordination Framework for Disasters and Planned Events replaces the Regional Disaster Plan, which the City of Federal Way has been signatory to. The framework focuses on five key areas in emergency management, those being direction and control, information collection, public information, communications, and the heart of the framework is resource management. There's a benefit to us signing, or the City of Federal Way signing this framework. What it does is it puts in place several points of contact that our regional partners can call if they need assistance, as well as if the City of Federal Way needs assistance. We already have those contacts established. It also already addresses how reimbursement happens, how invoicing happens, reimbursement, as well as the request and resource request of that. The framework does not replace any other agreements currently in place, nor does it replace any mutual aid agreements already established. It actually encourages the use of those agreements first. The last piece of it is the agreement does not obligate the City of Federal Way. So if we're asked, we have the option to say no, depending on what the current situation is. If the City of Federal Way does say yes, those resources remain to the City of Federal Way, and the City of Federal Way can recall those resources within a 24-hour notice. So that's kind of the general background of the framework. And I'll address any concerns or questions this time.
All right. Ray, you and I have been speaking about this Cascadia event that has received a lot of attention by way of the New Yorker article and subsequent media about that. Let's talk about that after we don't want to talk to you about what steps are going to be taken to prepare for something along those lines.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That being said, Council, any questions? All right. All those in favor?
Is a motion?
Oh, I'm sorry. Councilmember Honda.
I knew you were looking at me
exactly,
for a reason.
Yes, exactly.
I move approval of the Regional Coordination Framework for Disaster and Planned Events and authorize the mayor to sign on behalf of the City of Federal Way.
Second.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Now we're ready for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Thank you. Just very briefly, Ray, can you talk about, many people may not be aware of the article in the New Yorker that appeared just recently about the Cascadia subduction of a event, a possibility, about how we're about 100 years overdue for a Cascadia event. Can you talk a little bit about discussions we're having and about what you have planned in this effort?
Yes, sir. So there's several things we're looking at. Since 2009, earthquake has been, our central focus. We went back to Emmitsburg, got graded by FEMA, passed with flying colors, and I want to say the majority of that was based on what would most likely happen with either a deep earthquake or a shallow type earthquake. We do have the Cascadia subduction zone, potential magnitude 9.0 or greater, very similar to the 2012 Japan subduction zone event. Been working with the mayor, kind of ironing out what would be our worst case scenarios in the event that the city of Federal Way and the surrounding area becomes what I would call a virtual island, with the tide flats, the Green River Valley, all of those high potential liquefaction areas. It could be very, very strongly likelihood of the city of Federal Way and our immediate surrounding area becoming a virtual island for anywhere from 14 to 30 days before we start seeing help arrive. So we've kind of addressed some life safety issues, those being our core important areas, working on how would we provide water and other essential supplies to our community. Been working with our member partner agencies, Lake Haven, the school district, South King Fire, St. Francis Hospital. Been working with our community emergency response team, our CERT teams, of which we have a great resource in the community with those volunteers. So we're chipping away at all these what we would call worst case scenarios. What we're looking at doing from August forward is just take one of those worst case scenarios, say if the hospital becomes non-operational and we have to evacuate the hospital. What does that mean for us if there's no place for them to really go? Also been working with the National Guard. They're focusing on the Cascadia subduction zone and how would they provide resources into this area. But I want to say just two last things. And one, the New York article, I want to say, addresses the key impacts. Their main statement, everything west of I-5, is probably not accurate. Local earthquake USGS people are saying they're addressing that, and it's not applicable to the west or south sound. The Pacific coastline, if it gets hit by a tsunami, that would be a significant impact to them, and to use their language, the coastline could be toast. But here in the Puget Sound, the tsunami generated from a Cascadia subduction zone, all we'll probably see here is significant strong currents, okay? And our tsunami threat here after a subduction zone earthquake would be potential landslides into the Sound.
Okay. So. Much like happened in 1949.
That's correct, sir.
Okay. All right. Well, that's we're going to continue working on this. I'll keep the council involved. Obviously, some of the major issues are my concern is making sure of material distribution, what that looks like. We're going to be reaching out to the school district for utilization of school district property should an event like this occur. Water security issues in regard to making sure that in the case of an emergency, how would we get not only our rations out, but what the plan is for that. And also water and those kinds of things. But these are the kinds of things, obviously, you don't necessarily want to plan for, but it's our responsibility to do so.
That's correct.
That's why it's great to have you in this job. Any quick, Council Member Moore.
You know, Mr. Mayor, thank you so much. I just have to say that, and I know I keep talking about AmeriCorps, but that had a really profounding effect on me during my 2 years of service. And during that tenure, we actually participated in the CERT program, and I know that I've met many CERT members that were training in this council chambers, and I just want to say thank you for your leadership on that and for the staff that have been supporting our volunteers, and you know, just because it's in my heart, I have to say that I think it'd be kind of fun if all the elected officials participated in the CERT program. I think there's something to be said when you have elected officials that are partaking in that and stepping up to the plate and really working together as one community to take care of one another during disasters. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to say that several years ago we did have training on it, and we actually had some city staff go out. I think it was Virginia or Maryland somewhere.
It was It was Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania?
Yeah.
Okay. And yeah. Anyway, they went out and had training on it. The council itself had a lot of training. And we actually had a simulated day where people had different roles to play. And, you know, it might be good to do that again with us a little bit just to bring things up to snuff. But we spent a lot of time on that, learning about that and what facilities might be available, what would be saved, what wouldn't, and, you know, the minimum requirements you should have in your house. So.
That's right. That was in 2000.
Pets. And pets, too.
And pets. That was in 2009. And Emmitsburg is, that's right. And we're talking about, we periodically do what they refer to as tabletop exercises in this very room with practicing with mock press conferences and what the greater Federal Way EEOC, how it responds. This is obviously one of the major, the would be the headquarters of the EEOC for the greater Federal Way area, but it's multi-jurisdictional with the Lake Haven School District, South King Fire. Councilmember Moore, Honda.
Thank you. That's the second time you've done that.
Sorry.
No problem. I'm not saying it is. I have a question. One of the news reports that came out after this article was that we should have a supply for 10 days of water and food. You know, it used to always be 3 to 5 days. So is 10 days a new recommendation?
Yes. Actually, the profession's trying to move to a 7 to 14 day encouragement of having supplies on hand. For our area, I want to say the lesson learned was from the 06 windstorm. You know, after day 3, the majority of the area in Western Washington still did not have power. And that went on for a good 10 to 12 days. Some areas still didn't have power. So that's what we're slowly moving to, is the 7 to 14 days. The FEMA and all the emergency management agencies below that, you know, have done such a good job that 3 days, 3 ways is still stuck in a lot of people's mindsets. But in reality, a 7 to 14 day supply is what is going to be really needed in order for outside resources to get in and start helping.
So how do we educate people about that? Because I was surprised to hear that. And I've worked on, through PTA and the school district, on emergency management things. And so I was a little surprised to hear 10 days, because I don't have 10 days worth of water at my house for us.
Well, that's exactly what Ray and I have been discussing in the past week or 2 weeks now, is this getting this information out about, and that's what we're going to be working with the school district, is a large-scale information campaign to the public about supplies, about resource numbers, about gathering areas or resource distribution areas. It's very important for us to be prepared.
Well, but even the school district doesn't have, you know, they went on the three-day supply,
right,
too.
Yeah, that's why one of the first things I did upon getting into office was I directed our emergency manager to double the amount of water that we had at City Hall for emergency and making sure that we have the resources. But I think it's for purpose of this information, that's what Ray is going to be working on right now, is getting an information sheet out to all of the public, probably a two-sided postcard that will be mailed out to every household.
Thank you.
Councilmember Moore?
Yeah, I'm so sorry. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Channel 21, they actually, at one point, they had a whole series on what to do and how to be prepared. And I remember Natalie, I think was her name, that was a part of that. And I think that's something that should be revisited at some point.
It's a great idea. I like that idea, the utilization of New Day Federal Way. Councilmember Sefa Dawson.
Yeah, I don't know if you have this information, but I'm in my car a lot. So is there like a recommendation for what kind of supplies and how long?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's scary.
That's a great idea. And everybody's got cars, and all cars have radios. So most cars have radios. But that's the kind of thing where, you know, where information is going to be distributed. So we're working on it. We'll keep you involved as this process goes on, and we'll make sure when we do the tabletop exercise, likely in this room, that you'll be invited and request to participate. All right, great. Okay, authorization. Thank you very much, Ray. Great job.
Thank you.
More to follow on that. I'm going to have Ray give an update here pretty soon. Item D, authorization to submit water quality storm water capacity grant. Staff report by Teresa Thurlow, surface water manager.
Good evening, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, members of the council. I'm here today to present information on the policy question. Should the City of Federal Way submit a water quality stormwater capacity grant application with the Washington Department of Ecology? We were recently notified that funding is available for a capacity grant this year. The capacity grant has been one issued through the Department of Ecology since 2009, and it's actually been instrumental in funding the surface water program, Storming the Sound with Salmon Education Partnership Program. We were able to develop and implement an utility asset management program with these funds. And we've also been doing water quality monitoring and operational maintenance with these funds. So we have, as I said, been notified that the capacity grant is available. There are funds available, and the application deadline is July 30th.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Teresa. Any questions, Council? All right. Councilmember Selsky, do you have a motion?
I do, Mayor Farrell. I move to authorize the submittal of a water quality storm water capacity grant application to the Washington State Department of Ecology.
Second.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Matter passes unanimously. Thank you, Teresa, again. Okay. Item E, Ethics Board reappointment. Deputy Mayor Burbage.
Thank you. I move to reappoint James England as an alternate member of the Ethics Board with a term expiring June 30th, 2018.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? All right. It passes. Great. Council reports. Councilmember Cefadasa.
I have nothing to report.
All right. Thank you. Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. I'd like to make sure that everyone knows about the Salmon Bake. It's Friday. The mayor did talk about it. It's our 59th annual Salmon Bake. And tickets are $17 up until you come there, unless you're a senior citizen, and then they go to $20. So if you'd like to buy tickets, you can go online. Go to the Kiwanis webpage, the Noon Kiwanis webpage, and you can buy them online, or you can find a Kiwanian somewhere in the city or call me. I have tickets still. I'd also like to talk about the safety day that we had at the farmers market. It was an event put on by the Noon Kiwanis. The police department, the fire department was there, and the Kiwanis Club gave away 170 bicycle helmets. So we have 170 safer children here in Federal Way, and that was a great. That's up. Last year we gave away 100, so that was quite an increase. And that is my report. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Oh, one more thing. A note. Representative Kochmar asked me to say that the state also has $1.5 million in the budget for the Redondo Boardwalk. She forgot to say that. And that work will be completed as soon as possible.
That's great. Great news. All right. Councilmember Selsky.
Thanks, Mayor Farrar. We also have another important upcoming event in the city. Fundraiser for Fusion. It's their 22nd annual summer art event, and it occurs on Wednesday, August 5th, 3 to 9 p.m. at the Dumas Bay Center. It's a great day. The weather's always great. There's a lot of vendors and a lot of art there, and it's just a really great event for a worthy cause, which is, of course, our own Fusion, which takes care of needy families and homeless families in the city. And so anyway, it's called Casa Bugulu this year, and it looks to be a great event. So hope we can get great attendance at this event for a great cause. And that's it. Thank
All
you.
Right, great. Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. A couple things. A couple hours ago, I came back from Sedona, Arizona. Beautiful place if you haven't been there. And if you need a place to stay at, you can come on over to my parents' place. That being said, it was really interesting because they actually have a performing arts center and a school, of course. And the reason why I shared this is right next to the school in the open field, there is a rather large scale rows of, I just now lost the solar panels. And that actually powers up the school and the Performing Arts Center. Now, Arizona and Washington State are massively different. Arizona equals sun, Washington equals out some sun, rain, clouds. And although the weather has been really good, but it was just an interesting observation, you know, and you know, that's something that continues to be important to me and to, I'm sure, all of us. And, you know, I just want to reiterate my thanks to the chief of staff for and to the mayor's office for, you know, answering my questions and keeping an open mind towards the future. I know there was a bill in the legislature that would have really assisted us in incentives, but unfortunately the bill died. House Bill 1923, if I recall correctly, Representative Gail Tarleton, who was a prime sponsor of that. And so that's something I'm going to continue working on, but perhaps for the future. At any rate, I also wanted to say thank you to for Michael for really developing the performance measurement report. I had, like I said, I had that feeling that was the first time that we'd ever done that. And, you know, it might have been a little confusing to listen to what I was saying, but I was just so excited that we had such a document and that I'm just looking forward for just ways of how are we looking at improving the community development department. I also wanted to say that thank you, a huge thank you to all of our legislators. I know that Representative Carol Gregory just left. I must say that that's the longest I've ever seen a representative stay at the council chamber. So, Tim, if you'd pass on a verbal note to Representative Carol Gregory, my thanks for that. And I really just want to say thank you. I mean, what they did this year was incredible. They are playing a huge role in implementing our economic development strategy and plan. And this is an exciting time for Fed Away. I know I keep saying that, and I will continue to say that because results will start to show, I think. And what they did, what Senator Mark Miloscia did in delivering for Fed Away for the Performing Arts and Conference, Performing Arts and Event Center was just brilliant. It definitely surprised me quite a bit. So I just want to say thanks to all of our lawmakers for working together on that. And this Thursday, I will be attending the Mental Illness and Drug Dependency Oversight Committee. So I look forward to continuing to learn on that, and I will certainly come back. Even though I'm an alternate member, I look forward to bringing back information to the council. Thank you so much, and
great, thank you. Councilmember Duclos.
Thank you very much. I had the pleasure of visiting the local opening of the offices of State Representative Linda Kochmar and Senator Mark Miloscia. They're sharing an office over there, and it's quite nice. And again, got to thank them for what they did down there on our behalf. And I will say I was in the mayor's office one day when he called Senator Miloscia to bring him up to speed and to get his support for what we were doing. And so it was nice that they worked together and we came through with help for that. The Policy Issues Committee of Sound Cities met last Wednesday, the same night as the debate. So unfortunately, I was not able to be there. I was watching the debates, or was at the debates, but they had an important issue on there, and that is the Best Start for Kids. And they are sending, the group agreed to send a motion to the board to send to King County to put it on the November ballot. And I think that's something that people should pay a lot of attention to, because I think there's an awful lot of good things in there, as well as measurements to make sure that we're on target for doing what we should be doing. And the only other thing I have is the next meeting of the Finance, Economic Development, and Regional Affairs Committee is Tuesday, July 28th at 4:30 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor Burbage.
Thank you very much. I attended a meeting this morning of the South County Area Transportation Board, and there were a couple of items of particular interest. One is that this board, which is known as an acronym as Skateboard, is joining with the other policy boards in King County for transportation and sponsoring a regional conference. It's planned at this point for October 9th. It'll be start in the morning at 8 o'clock and run until about 3:00. And this will be addressing planning for technology and transportation, new areas of emphasis. So it should be a fascinating conference. The board is actually putting a small amount of money as a co-sponsor for this this planned event, so there will be more information provided as time goes on. Additionally, we had a presentation on a couple of other items, and one was a travel study that is ongoing, and they mentioned addressing the travel to colleges in the area, but had left out Highline for some reason, and I suggested that in the future they include our closest college in their analysis. I also wanted to include my appreciation to our legislators. They have done such important work, as has been mentioned, for our city this year in providing some capital funding for, especially for the Performing Arts and Events Center, for Carl Grosch Field, and for the trail areas, and in addition, passing that transportation package is truly a huge benefit to not only Federal Way with the Triangle, but also the other regional measures that were included in that. That will benefit all of us, and in terms of the job numbers increases as well. And I also want to mention an event going on this weekend, and that is the International Storytelling Festival, repeating this year again, which will be held at Powellswood Gardens on Dashpoint Road at approximately between 8th and 4th Avenue Southwest. With shuttle service available easily at Sacagawea Middle School. So the big day for that is Saturday. I hope many people can take it in. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. All right, with that, we are adjourned. Great meeting, everybody.